Continental Free Trade Area, I mean, when you stand back and look at it, one cannot dispute the importance of trade integration in Africa as part of Africa's regional integration. But trade integration has to be closely related to integration of economies and production. Now, the CFTA, therefore, being launched, or as the CFTA is taking forward something which has been envisioned for many years. That's in principle. But there are a number of concerns that we have about what is actually unfolding and the content. One, a complex and far-reaching policy change like a continental free trade area cannot be done with a rushed timetable that is being done with. Secondly, the rush has meant that the depth of analysis and preparation and consultation, which will ensure a connection between trade policy and the development of productive capacity for the economic integration of Africa rather than simply liberalizing trade across Africa, that work we don't think has been adequately done. Connected with that is a third issue, which seems to be that when you listen to the arguments made for the CFTA, it really seems to be more influenced by notions of open regionalism, which sees regional integration as simply part of opening your regional economies up to interface with the global economy, which is a different thing from the classical development-based vision of regional integration, which sees regional integration as a transformative thing, which allows African countries to kind of de-emphasize raw material commodity export and build productive capacities around things that they need for consumption and processing, you know, within the continent. I have a real fear that the process as it is going on, its results will contain as many problems as benefits. The CFTA process has definitely not been consultative enough. And there are two dimensions of this. The African Union itself has a schizophrenic attitude to working with non-state actors. In some corners of the AU, you get consultation. In others, they don't want to know non-state actors. There are governments which domestically are very hostile to non-state actors, particularly civil society organizations, and they come very loud, you know. So the AU does not insist on a certain minimum quality of domestic engagement with non-state actors, which it also then fosters, you know, at the intergovernmental level. TWN Africa has been engaged in consultations around the African continent in different regions on the CFTA, and the same story of deficient engagement with non-state actors was the picture that we got. I think today's event was very productive. Given that we were trying to provide information, I mean, for me, therefore, what came out as what people didn't know was, it may be a strange thing, it was an important positive discovery, because it gave us an idea about the size of the task of raising awareness. It also meant that the information that was made available in this meeting would be better appreciated. But what it also highlighted is that the negotiating process really suffers from all the systemic defects of just an absence of consultative mechanisms, you know, around the biggest areas of policymaking. We've seen that kind of manifest. And this meeting, in the conclusions that we came to about how we can work together with the Ministry of Trade and Industry to improve, you know, consultative engagements within the window of March to July, that shows you that, you know, there's willingness on all sides to work on this issue. The agreement that CSO should do more among themselves also to share knowledge. I think it's an important, you know, positive development. And of course, the collaboration with the Ministry of Trade and Industry is the kind of thing that should be routine. So for me, really, Taiwan Network being part of convening this thing, I mean, I think it's a big plus. We also learn quite a bit from it in terms of what needs to be done. And in a way, when you have a successful meeting like this, it throws up more work. So how we respond to it, you know, is the next big challenge.
The first thing I'll mention on the side of the benefits is that it increases a company's market size. Of course, you have more countries, if you shall put it that way, that you can access to send your products or sell your products. The second one is that you will learn from the market because there is competition out there. If you are just within your domestic market, you wouldn't get much from it, in terms of competition. So when you go out there, it helps you to understand the market and also learn to compete. Once you're able to meet the competition outside, domestic market is just easy for you. I don't think there has been enough engagement with the private sector, and I think there's need to unwind the process so that we get involved as soon as possible, because we are the players. At the end of the day, it is meant for the private sector players. I think going forward, we need to look at the indigenous companies. And when I say indigenous, those people who own nationals, who own the companies. Sometimes we have infiltration of multinationals. They are already on the continent, and they will always find a way of surviving on the continent, and they have all that it takes to also take the market share. By the end of the day, when they make their profits, they are not on the continent, they send it outside. So we need to get the indigenous domestic private sector to get involved, because they are able to keep their money here. And that is related to local content at the level of shareholding, at the level of management, and at the level of employment.
There are a lot of benefits that will accrue when we seriously implement the African Continental Free Trade Area. It will encourage what we call the foreign direct investment. You know, because normally people, some foreign investors will come, they will enter into joint partnership with Ghanaian entrepreneurs and then produce to export to the continent. There is a goodwill for a lot of countries to import from Ghana, from the African continent. So you find out that and the studies that have already been done show that Ghana stands to gain a lot, you know, when it fully embraces the African continental free trade area. We will say that there is actually the need for the civil society, from identifiable associations like Association of Ghana Industry, Federation of Ghanaian Exporters, the Chamber of Commerce and Industry and others, to collaborate with us so that at the end of the day, we'll be able to truly identify our priority areas that we should, products that we should put under the exclusive list.
I hope that most of what is being presented to us are proposals and not agreements, particularly when we already have had experience with, quite frankly, bad agreements which have not accrued very much to the local productive sector in terms of the trade benefits.